coalition forces and begin striking selected targets of military importance.
It would be a decision which could only be taken once.
There's no argument over the choice between peace and war.
Unconfirmed reports about Gaddafi being captured.
This morning, I want to talk about the future of Europe.
Burning Point.
Hello and welcome to the show. With me, Екатерина Кудашкина. Today we're going to look at a hidden agenda in Ukrainian crisis. Mr. Turchynov, the acting president of the country, is a Baptist pastor with strong links to the neo-Pentecostal religious group. The acting prime minister, Mr. Yatsenyuk, is said to belong to the Scientology movement. Now, there were Greek Catholics in Maidan who played a prominent role, together with a number of the so-called new religious movements. So, in this program, we're exploring the hidden religious agenda behind Maidan and Ukrainian crisis. Our guest speaker today is Professor Alexander Dvorkin, a Russian-American anti-cult activist and vice president of the European Federation of Centers of Research and Information on Sectarianism, which is the umbrella organization for anti-cult groups in Europe.
Well, actually, there is quite a serious and noticeable religious factor in recent developments in the Ukraine, as far as I can see. There are several religious groups and several religious cults which play quite prominent role in those events. First of all, the Union Church, or what they call it politically correct, it's Greek Catholic, though they are not Greeks, definitely. But Union Church, in fact, it played a very prominent and very, I'd say, violent role. There were lots of Union priests who preached there, I mean, in all their liturgical vestments, and they said openly horrible things, that we should talk to our enemies with a language of bullets, we should talk to our enemies with language of nooses on their necks. So we should talk to our enemies with language of death, but there should be no forgiveness, etc. And so those were like priests in liturgical vestments who said those things. And they organized prayer points in Maidan. They served liturgies right there where blood was spilled, and they would give communion indiscriminately to people who took part in those, you know, violent events, who applied direct violence towards other people, and immediately they would receive communion. So that spoke for itself. They were Baptists, but of course Baptist is not a destructive cult such as Neo-Pentecostals. However, definitely they also played their part, and very kind of nationalistic part, which is, I should say, you know, to be on a fair side, it's not typical for Baptists to be so nationalistic, but however, these Ukrainian Baptists were. And you mentioned Scientology. It's a very interesting connection because, of course, everybody accuses Mr. Yatsenyuk, the acting prime minister of Ukraine, self-appointed by part of Ukrainian Supreme Rada, to be a prime minister. There were a lot of media reports which called him Scientologist. I don't think he is an open Scientologist, because open Scientologists, well, like Tom Cruise, for example, I mean, they speak about Scientology, they promote Scientology, they PR Scientology, etc. Yatsenyuk definitely doesn't do it, and never has done it. However, what we know that Yatsenyuk, before his political career, he did take several Scientology courses and paid for it. It's when he was in a banking career. What it means? It means that, well, the basic Scientological procedure, basic Scientological act, is so-called auditing. Auditing is, each Scientologist has to go through auditing many, many times. It costs quite expensively, and each auditing session lasts for between 2 and 4 hours, and people go over and over and over. During the session, it is conducted with the help of a device which Scientologists called electropsychometer, and which is sort of a primitive form of a lie detector. And people have to tell everything which they've done during their lives, everything which they're ashamed of, all their sexual history, all their most hidden thoughts and desires, and whatever violations of law they could have done or might have done. And everything that happened also to their relatives, to their friends, to their acquaintances and everything. And this all is being recorded audio and video. And it's kept. Every person gets its own file in Scientology archive, and it's kept, and information is added to each person's file. So if, and which is very likely, Yatsenyuk went through auditing, then definitely Scientology has something to control him. That is the most important. You know, if he would have been an open Scientologist, I mean, it would have been very bad, but still, at least you would know what to expect from him. But when a person, actually, Yatsenyuk calls himself a Greek Catholic Uniat, and there were Uniat priests that confirmed that he is an acting Uniat. Yes, perhaps he is acting Uniat, but at the same time, Scientology has some keys with which they could really control his behavior and control his actions. And I believe this is very dangerous.
This is Burning Point. We're exploring the hidden religious agenda behind Maidan and Ukrainian crisis. Our guest speaker is Professor Alexander Dvorkin, Vice President of European Federation of Centers of Research and Information on Sectarianism.
There are so many different organizations with seemingly different agenda acting in a concerted effort this time. Does that imply that they are acting in the interests of a single force?
Well, it's very difficult to say. Perhaps not, but definitely there is a single force that tries to control it. Of course, it's no secret that Scientology, as of 1994, has been cooperating very closely with Central Intelligence Agency of the United States of America. The State Department of the United States of America lobbies the interests of Scientology in all the countries of the world, and Scientology apparently shares some of the information and gathers with Central Intelligence Agency. So that means that at least in the Yatsenyuk case, Yatsenyuk could be controlled by the CIA. One cultic movement, which I haven't mentioned so far, is the neo-pagan movement, which was very active in Maidan and is very active in the Ukraine for present days. They're so-called nativists, which comes from the word native, of course. And nativism is an international movement which calls for a revival of pre-Christian beliefs of each local country. And it's interesting that this nativist neo-pagans, a lot of them are closely connected to neo-Nazi movement. Of course, National Socialist Party of Germany was in itself a destructive cult, occult neo-pagan tendencies. Modern-day neo-paganists, they look forward to some Nazi practices. And so-called right sector and other extremist Ukrainian groups, they are very much connected to the neo-pagan movement. Returning to your question, in the United States there are several agencies which say that they monitor the religious freedom throughout the world, and they write reports about religious freedom in different countries. And it's interesting that many of those agencies, they kind of overlap in their responsibilities, and still there are many more, it seems, that than it is needed. But still, the government of the United States thinks it's feasible to support all those groups. And there are reports about religious freedom, which is done by the Congress of the United States and by the State Department and by other groups, which are partially or totally supported by the federal government of the United States. And what it boils down to, that all those groups, they mostly support the, what people call politically correct, the new religious movements, though they are not necessarily new, not necessarily religious, and not necessarily movement. In other words, sects and cults. And alas, but cults became a very important factor in international politics, and it is used by several governments, first of all, and mostly by the United States, as a factor of international pressure, as an attempt to apply pressure to those governments that they disagree with, and as their agents of influence. It is interesting that one of those functionaries that are supposed to watch the religious freedom, she said very openly that religious freedom is very important because first comes religious freedom and then comes the freedom of trade. And it speaks for itself. First come some cults, then McDonald's, then some other signs of another factors of American life.
We have heard many statements coming from Vatican about the necessity of returning to peace developments in Ukraine. Do you think that the great churches, which are Russian Orthodox and the Catholic Church, do you think they have any leverage on what's going on there?
Well, to a degree, but actually this Union Church or Greek Catholic Church, which was instituted by the Roman Catholic Church in the Ukraine in the very end of the 17th century, now Vatican cannot really control it. Perhaps to a degree it can control it, but not really. So that's quite a problem. Genie came out of the battle and it does what it does. And actually a lot of unions, their slogan is neither to Moscow nor to Rome.
But this time the Pope is the Jesuit, and the Jesuits are famous for their behind-the-scenes activities.
Well, that is true of 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th century, etc. But in 20th century, Jesuits really became different, because Jesuits, in fact, in Latin America, Jesuits were they were behind the liberation theology. They became sort of very much pro-Marxist and pro-revolutionary. It's the present Pope Francis, he is not pro-revolutionary, but in a way, the way he behaves shows that he accepted part of this legacy. Now in Roman Catholic Church there are, if I may call them so, a new Jesuits. So new groups which play the role which Jesuits played in previous century. For example, a very secretive, I would say even cultic order, Opus Dei, and neo-catechumenate, another very strange and cultic movement, and some others. So for this matter, I don't think, well, of course, the word Jesuit became proverbial, but it is outdated. Nowadays, Jesuits are different.
Dr. Dvorkin, thank you so much.
And just to remind you, our guest speaker was Professor Alexander Dvorkin, a Russian-American anti-cult activist and vice president of the European Federation of Centers of Research and Information on Sectarianism.
Burning Point.
We're exploring the hidden religious agenda behind Maidan and Ukrainian crisis. And now we are joined by our next guest speaker, Maurizio Torrialta, who is investigative journalist based in Italy, sharing with us his views on modern foreign policy pursued by Vatican.
A very tense situation in Ukraine and in Russia. The ad of the United Kiev, which is a bad move, is not a move towards a better situation. It's a move which brings the wind of conflict. And I didn't hear any critics of that movement of the added Shia in Kiev. I would have liked to listen to hear some critique of the escalation of the tension in that area. If he's a real top out of game, of the power game, I hope he's a real top out of the power game, of the international game. I hope so. But for the moment, in our inside policy behaves fantastically. But I'm still waiting to see if he will do the same for international policy, because I'm a little bit doubtful about it for many complex situations. That is my opinion.
Dr. Torrialta, thank you so much.
And just to remind you, this time our guest speaker was Maurizio Torrialta, investigative journalist based in Italy. Well, and with this we end this edition of Burning Point, brought to you by me, Katerina Kudashkina. Thank you so much for staying with us. Goodbye, and take care.